It's my pleasure to be your moderator for the day today. So, Bula and good morning to you all. Bula. Ambassador up to the stage for the garlanding. Thank you, could we please?
Your Excellency, Ambassador of Korea to Fiji, people from government, our friends, I understand you have some friends from Korea with us, members of the academia, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, Bula Binaka, and a very good morning to you all. I think we should all have smiles on our face. We're on Denarau, it's a nice sunny day. And we're talking about energy, so we need to have a lot of energy ourselves this morning. First of all, it gives me great pleasure to be here this morning to deliver these congratulatory remarks. And I must start off by thanking the government of Korea, the Embassy of Korea, for organizing this event and also for inviting me to be here at this symposium. And I'd like to extend my sincere thanks to the government and the people of Korea through the embassy and the official development assistance arm, KOICA, Korean International Cooperation Agency, for its commitment to the development of Fiji and the cooperative partnership with my ministry and with government. Fiji has been having strong partnership with the government of Korea in the various areas of development, including, as we will be talking about today, renewable energy development. Since I took up this office as the Minister for Infrastructure, one of the first projects I commissioned as Minister for Infrastructure was the Namara Village Microgrid Solar Project in Kandavu. And that was a project that was an example of collaboration between the government of Fiji and the government of Korea. It was a hybrid microgrid program that we have on the village of Namara. That project costs around $3.4 million. And the government of Korea committed $3 million to the project. That project has benefited more than 200 people, including a primary school with a school roll of more than 100 students. So we've already witnessed the effectiveness of the collaboration and the assistance that we're getting from the government of Korea towards renewable energy in our islands here in Fiji. As has been pointed out by Her Excellency, the government of Korea is also proposing to fund the installation of the 1.5 megawatt solar grid connect in Tavuni. KOICA is committing US $3 million on this project. And I have noted that 1.9 million is already included in the 2020 budget. And I know there's a commitment also to the building of the road that will start that project on Mua in Tavuni. So that is something that Tavuni is looking forward to. And we expect that after that project is in place, the whole island of Tavuni could become a renewable energy island. Because we have the hydro, we have the solar, it should be able to meet the requirements of that entire island. And that is what we hope to see in the future. The construction is expected to commence in early 2020 and will take at least 2 years to complete. The development of this project, as I've said, will supplement the existing 700 kilowatt hydro project in Somosom and will provide reliable and sustainable power supply to the whole of Tavuni. So we're seeing good progress in Tavuni. We're also seeing good progress here in Vitilevu, and we hope that other islands will follow. There's dreams of also of the island of Ovalau. Perhaps there might be a few other islands in Fiji that can become totally renewable energy based. Having considered this assistance, ladies and gentlemen, The support from COICA complements Fiji's drive to transform the electricity supply on the island to 100% renewable energy. Our transition to a blue-green economy requires enabling policy and a legislative environment. This would create attractive investment and business development opportunities, and our strive towards decarbonizing our economy is at the center of our development plans. We are committed to reduce our carbon emissions and to work together with industrialized countries to keep the global temperature well below the 2 degrees Celsius, and for us in the Pacific, no more than 1.5 degrees. However, our geographical position in the global map increases our vulnerability to the inevitable impacts of climate change. Our 5 and 20-year national development plans and other national planning frameworks set a platform and a strong foundation for our future prosperity and well-being. We have set very ambitious targets, which is to provide electricity access to all Fijians by the year 2021 and to increase renewable share in electricity generation to 100% by the year 2036. To achieve this target will require concrete, inclusive, and holistic participation of all key partners and stakeholders. Ladies and gentlemen, local institutions continue to play a key role on the research and development of new and emerging renewable energy technologies entering our market. However, our current engagement with these institutions is on an ad hoc basis. There needs to be clear direction and innovative programs in place where government, institutions, and donor partners work together to identify best technologies and solutions that meets and addresses our local needs. The adage which says one size does not fit all is true, as the performance of renewable energy technologies varies in different countries because of different climatic conditions and other factors. We need to develop homegrown or tailor-made solutions that best suit our needs. Last week, I had officiated at a workshop in Suva organized by JICA on the hybrid power projects in the Pacific Island countries. The project is from 2017 to 2022. It covers Fiji, Marshall Islands, Kiribati, Tuvalu, and the FSM. One of the outputs of the program is to establish a regional training center for hybrid training at the EFL office in Lotoka. I believe that this is an example of a kind of partnership program that we need to develop and strengthen in our country. Ladies and gentlemen, no one can deny the fact that our transition to a blue-green economy will require significant upfront investment. According to the study commissioned by the United Nations Environment, the critical mass of annual investment necessary to support transition to a green economy during the period from 2010 to 2050 period represents approximately 2% of global GDP. That's a lot of money. These funding requirements for environmentally sustainable investments significantly exceed what the public sector can offer. So this requires systematic involvement from private sources of funding. Ladies and gentlemen, considering our local context, to implement our nationally determined contribution target of 30% carbon emission by reduction by 2030 will require an investment of US $2.97 billion. Government cannot invest on this amount alone. We need to put in place innovative financial mechanisms and facilities which are easily accessible to everyone. Climate financing is one of the buzzwords that people are talking about in lots of international, regional, and national meetings and conferences. I believe this conference, the presentation this afternoon on the Green Climate Fund, will provide us some insights on the processes and requirements to access this funding. Ladies and gentlemen, before I conclude, I would once again congratulate the Embassy of the Republic of Korea and the organizers for arranging this symposium. Thank you very much. And I hope that there will be more constructive discussions and sharing of views and ideas during the symposium. With those few words, I wish the symposium every success. Thank you. Vinagwalevu, and kam samanida. Nagwalevu.